quarterback Quinn Ewers today, a whole lot of Arch Manning. What are your expectations for your sophomore quarterback?
Well, for Arch, when he gets in there, I just want to see him operate. He hasn't played football, real football, in about a year. So when he gets his op to go operate, be good for Quinn and the fans to see him. But a third-year starting quarterback, I know what he's about.
These fans, this environment, Coach, 18 enrollees that were here this spring, who are you expecting to really stand out today?
Well, there's going to be a group of these guys, and it's going to be fun to watch them all. There's a lot of new faces with transfers and freshmen. We'll see how it goes.
Thanks so much, Coach. Appreciate it.
All righty, thank you.
Thank you, Morgan. Pretty good crowd on hand here. The rain has stayed away for now, Fozzie. And as we take a look at the spring game rules, Sark mentioned to us this week that he's going to mix the ones and the twos. Don't put too much stock into who is, quote unquote, starting at each position with their group.
Yeah, we expect to see competition all four quarters. It's going to be an exciting game, and a mix up of guys make it competitive all the way through. So just be looking for some good time competition by some really good time players.
Will Stone set to kick off. Keep in mind, there are a few players not expected to play today. Baron Sorrell, Vernon Broughton, who's getting married this week.
In Paris.
We'll get more into that. Paris, Texas, that is. And Jahdae Barron, where they are giving a rest after dealing with some late season injuries at the end of last season. And obviously, they know what he can do. So again, just precautionary measures. Barron expected to sit this one out. Cloudy, overcast, 68 degrees, but we are ready to go here. Sark is as well. Now, he did tell us we won't see too much of Quinn Ewers in this game, maybe a series or two. What is left to prove for Ewers at this point in the spring game? Not much, but we are underway in the 2024 Orange and White spring game, the Will Stone kickoff. And again, it's non-contact as the play blown dead. And there's Matthew Golden. Sark couldn't stop talking about the special teams when we spoke with him, Fozzie, saying we should have a great return team this year. Golden expected to be a big part of that as Quinn Ewers get ready to take the opening snap for this offense. Ewers coming off that Big 12 championship game MVP performance. Texas's final year in the conference. Beside Quinn in the backfield for the white squad is Jaden Blue, the junior out of Houston. What a strong season. 6 yards per carry for Blue. Here we go. First one dropped off to Isaiah Bond, the transfer. He's wrapped up and taken down. Anthony Hill with a hard tackle there on the opening play.
Isaiah Bond right there shows off his speed. Sark's want to get him incorporated in his offense very quickly, and you saw it right there on the first play of the game.
Now, Sark recruited Bond heavily when he was with Alabama. He finally got him this year. As making the catch is Jonte Cook. So many transfers, so many new faces as a big part of this wide receiver core, Fozzie.
Yeah, especially new numbers as well. Jonte Cook was previously number two. Now he's taking over number one, picking up the first down, just like his number shows.
Quinn with the play action fake. That one batted and intercepted by Alfred Collins. The big man taking it to the house.
What an amazing play right there. Not what you want to see from the first team offense, but exactly what you're looking for from your first team defense. We talked about it already. How do you replace talent like like Tavondre Sweat and like Barron? This is what you got to do. Byron Murphy, I'm sorry. This is what you have to do. Ethan Burke bats it up. Then they play off each other, and Alfred Collins is a guy that's going to step up in a big way as he makes a big splash play right there.
Well, hey, listen, I'm having a flashback to his freshman year when he burst on the scene with that interception in the Alamo Bowl against Colorado. And just like that, the Orange squad goes up 7-0. You know, Alfred Collins was the third highest rated player on the Texas defense last year, according to Pro Football Focus. But Sark not only said this, Alfred told us yesterday he needs to be more consistent. Now is the time for him to shine.
Well, if you make plays like you just did right there, gives you an opportunity to shine. And we had a sit down with him yesterday, and I think one of the coolest things that he talked about was all it takes is 1 year. We saw Byron Murphy and Tavondre Sweat really excel in this past season. that's something that he's looking to do. He was in that same room with them. He saw the work that it took to get there. Now he's poised to have the success himself.
Well, just like that, Quinn is back on the field. I know they wanted to give him limited appearances, but maybe just a few more snaps here. After that score by Alfred Collins, C.J. Baxter in the backfield now. Went off 659 yards on the ground a season ago. And they get the carry stuffed up the middle.
What I do want to highlight, too, though, we saw Pony. You see two backs right there, Jaden Blue and C.J. Baxter in on that play. Expect to see some more of that 20 personnel being a part of what this offense wants to do.
Kelvin Banks told us C.J. Baxter has been extremely unselfish this spring. And what he meant by that was constantly blocking guys left and right, chipping when he comes out of the backfield, really putting his body on the line during the spring. Ewers steps up. And an incompletion on second down. Isaiah Bond was the intended target. Another look at Ewers.
Steps up in the pocket right there. You want to see a little bit more accurate throw on that. Isaiah Bond couldn't reach it. Incomplete pass. Now you're looking at third down for this Texas offense.
And you wonder how long, too, it takes to develop chemistry with new receivers. Texas replacing their top five receivers from a year ago as far as receptions are concerned. Ewers to his right. And that one is hauled in by Jonte Cook. A first down for the white squad.
What a phenomenal catch right there. You want to see somebody making a play against contested coverage. It doesn't get any tighter than what Malik Muhammad was able to do right there. And Jonte Cook, strong hands, finds a way to come down with it, pick up the first down for Texas O.
Muhammad couldn't have played any tighter coverage. A big year expected from the sophomore defensive back. Baxter working his way to his left. Brought down C.J. Baxter. Hey, listen, he had a strong Sugar Bowl, averaged 7 yards per carry against Washington in that loss.
Absolutely. This is something that the Texas defense did very well a season ago. You see the orange team, they're picking up right where they left off, stopping the run as they did during the season.
Averaged just under 5 yards per carry on the season. Gets a breather after a 1 yard gain. Jaden Blue back in the game. Ewers back to pass to his left. And wide of Isaiah Bond trying to hook up with the Alabama transfer early and often here. Bond led the Crimson Tide with 48 catches a season ago, Foss.
You mentioned it earlier, though. You talked about the timing issue. That's what you want to see in a spring game, is that timing issue being worked out. Such new faces receiving the ball. Isaiah Bond and Quinn Ewers just can't find it quite yet.
Third and long for Ewers and the white squad. Plenty of time. Ewers steps up and again intended for Bond, but couldn't connect.
That's another timing issue. Ball was thrown a little bit high. What I do want to say is this offensive line has given Quinn Ewers time in the pocket. Just got to find that connection. That's something that they will have to work on this season or in the summer to be able to have a successful season, especially with Isaiah Bond being a pivotal playmaker for this offense.
Now keep in mind, Texas does have a freshman punter, Michael Kern, coming in over the summer, but obviously not an early enrollee here for this game. So Charlie Ferris, the junior out of Houston, set to punt. And there we go. Fair catch at the 20 yard. And interceptions during his time there, Fozzie.
That sounds pretty good if you ask me. 81 touchdowns. Woo! What a high school career.
So here we go with Owens. Again, Owens and Lord expected to be the QBs for the third and fourth squad. Still haven't gotten a look at Arch Manning yet. That was Jarrett Gibson on the carry, the 5'10", 211-pound freshman out of Gainesville. Top 60 overall recruit in the ESPN 300. So many highly touted recruits on this squad that Sark told us is the deepest he has had since he arrived on the 40 acres. Hey, Owens can move. Few of these quarterbacks can run. Arch Manning as well.
I don't know if you would classify him as a dual threat guy. Trey Owens, that is.
He's working on it.
He is working on it, but that's smart mechanics right there. You get pressure on the back end, find a way, don't make a bad play negative, find a way to get some positive yardage out of that. That's what he was able to do, tuck it and go get positive yards.
Number 17 rated pocket passer in the nation, according to ESPN. And Sark called him just a straight up natural passer. As that one hauled in by Ryan Wingo, spitting and finally taken down. Wingo, the freshman out of St. Louis.
First look at a guy that is a five-star recruit, big size, new number five, not Adonai Mitchell anymore, but looking like he can make plays similar to that. Ryan Wingo, first catch as a Texas Longhorn in this spring game for the Orange team.
You look at all these new faces among the receivers, Bond, Wingo, Golden as well. They give up the middle to Savion Red, who was so effective in that Red Cat package a year ago.
Absolutely. That was a guy that was able to feast in short yardage situations, getting his chance early this spring game to be able to showcase what he can do as an every down back and not just in short yardage situations.
You get a good look at Kyle Flood, the offensive line coach, offensive coordinator as well. I mean, we had a chance to talk to him at length. What a charismatic guy. You can see why he's been so successful on the recruiting trail, as that one hauled in again by Wingo. And there was an interesting conversation we had with Flood when he told us, listen, I was a high school math teacher in Queens, New York. I have an analytical approach to the game, and that's why I think I have such good chemistry with Sark, because he is so creative and inventive in his thinking. We balance each other well. We really play off each other well with the analytical aspect and the creative aspect between Sark and Kyle Flood. Again, it's Red with the carry. Wardell Mack with the tackle. But going back to Sark's thoughts on the depth of this team, said it's the deepest team he's ever had here. They could go four deep on the O-line if they need to.
Yeah, that's something that they could not do 2 years ago whenever he first got into this Texas program. Now you can see where this program is and the state of it and the health, and it's headed in the right direction.
Just a loaded squad that only lost one starter from a season ago. Owens, that one a little bit too high for Parker Livingstone, as the freshman was pressured in the pocket.
I believe Coach Sark overrided the call right there, overruled it, called it a sack. So now you're looking at a third and 15, third and 14 situation. How does the young freshman here handle a third and long?
It's the first time in a while we've had a spring game without any kind of quarterback competition
that
for the starting role.
That is true.
Usually a lot of drama around this time of year on the 40 acres. So third and 15 now for the freshman, Trey Owens. Owens fires it over the middle, and that one hauled in on the run, and a touchdown by Thatcher Milton.
Hold on, we got a little yellow laundry down the field. What an unbelievable pocket presence, though, Trey Owens showed.
Illegal hands to the face. It's coming back.
Much to the ire of the fans as well. They don't like that call. Beautiful pocket right there. Obviously, you can't have the hands to the face like we saw on the left side. You negate a huge play right there by the left tackle.
Okay, it's close. I mean, they were hands to the face on the other side of the ball.
Yeah, but that's not what the referee called there. So you got to play what you call. Now you're in a third and forever situation. This is one of the times where, hey, you got to be smart here. The quarterback does not have to get it all in one play. Wait a minute. We got overruled again.
Well, Sark knows what the fans want.
Hands to the face on the defense.
See, oh, thank you.
You were right.
Thank you, Sark. I thought that's what I saw. Hands to the face on the other side of the ball as the defense was working on Trevor Goolsby. Take a look at Trevor Goolsby, the offensive lineman number 74. He is the recipient of hands to the face.
Left tackle right there. Yeah, you see it. right there. Zena, also an incoming freshman, has a ton of potential, big time size. Got to learn to bring those hands down. But ultimately, what a great job by Trevor Goosby, as well as that entire offensive line, allowing the time on a 3rd and 15 for Trey Owens to step up, find Thatcher Milton, put points on the board for the Orange yet again.
Wouldn't it be great if Sark could do that during the regular season, just overrule the officials, whatever he'd like. The Orange squad up 14-0. Maybe a correction there for the right. Zebras on what took place.
We also know Sark is an offensive-minded coach, so that might help a little bit as well.
There you go, Thatcher Milton with the touchdown, the senior out of Cyprus, the Cy Fair product, getting congratulated. And now let's see who ends up coming out to play QB for the white squad. We saw Quinn Ewers play the first two series, and I believe we may see the one and only Arch Manning lining up under center, number 16, and there he is. Sark told us we would see extended action from Arch today. Arch going deep. And that one is hauled in by DeAndre Moore for the touchdown. White squad is on the board. Manning to Moore.
What an absolute beautiful pass that was. Arch Manning comes in after this white offense was not able to find traction on their first two drives. Here's a surprise for you right here. Arch finds time, play action, freezes the defense, gives Arch the opportunity to pump fake to one side, and then lo and behold, there's his guy, DeAndre Moore. We were asking who's going to step up, make plays at this receiver position. Well, DeAndre Moore has showcased what he can do just in a small sample size with that play right there.
Arch Manning, 75 yards to Moore. Bert Auburn on for the extra point. And we got a 14-7 game. Big smile on the face of Arch Manning after the bomb to Moore. Some big plays early on. Manning and Owens with the big touchdown passes here in the 2024 spring game. He threw a 50-yard touchdown to Thatcher Milton. That was called back. And then overruled. There is the gift to Savion Red.
Finding some space right there on that run, something that you want to stay very consistent with. We also know Kyle Flood is calling the plays for this Orange team. Maybe he has a little upper hand in calling more run plays to see how his offensive linemen respond.
Kendrick Blackshire in on the tackle, the senior transfer from Alabama. Texas originally offered Blackshire back in 2018. Ended up passing, but has finally made his way to the Longhorns. Owens just got rid of it in time as he was under pressure.
Right on cue. Blackshire was the one that was able to force that pressure. He was able to read the play action, got out of it quickly, and then forced Trey Owens to get that ball, release it earlier than he wanted to.
That will do it for quarter number one. Well, the fans love to see offense, especially in a game like this. And Texas has delivered. Manning and Owens with touchdown passes. Orange up by 7 after 1. Big plays in quarter number one of the spring game. That's the story as Bevo looks on. We get ready to start quarter number two. But before we do, let's send it over to Morgan Uber, who's there with Sark. Morgan.
Coach, you were just telling us that this is the most impressive spring game you've seen, and it's just the first quarter. What is it that stood out to you here so far?
You know, it's just been a lot of fun. I mean, this is a great environment. Our fans have been awesome. Our players are playing loose, they're having fun, and it's been good football so far.
What'd you see with that officiating call there earlier?
Well, we were calling it the wrong way. They called number 19. I said, I'm glad I'm back here with you guys. There's 19s on defense, so we got the call right, and the Orange got the touchdown.
How different is this vantage point for you, standing behind the play, not on the sidelines, relinquishing those duties here today?
I have no stress level. It's all on these coaches. I'm just enjoying the game.
For our Arch Manning, what was the design of that play to DeAndre Moore?
Just a double post, got a blown coverage, and he saw it and laid it in there for a touchdown.
Awesome. Thanks, Coach. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Enjoy it.
Love it. Great spring start for the Longhorns offensively. Not a great start for the officials, but that's okay.
Still
working. Spring game as Arch looks on. Get ready to get set here as Sark allowing Kyle Flood, AJ Milwe, a number of assistants to call plays. And that one a bit too low for Milton. Was it hauled in? One more look at that one.
Ball was batted. It appeared to hit the ground before he was able to catch it. But it appears the orange is set to punt the ball regardless.
You know, one of the topics that I was interested in coming into this game was the red zone. Defensively, Texas terrific in the red zone last year. Offensively, they were 87th, but there's been so many big plays already that we haven't had an opportunity to see these offenses in the red zone after that punt. Let's send it back down to field level with Morgan. Or not. She's working on it. As we say in the business, she is efforting the story right now as we hit 14-minute mark in the second quarter. What did you make of quarter number one overall?
Back to your point about the red zone and how Texas had their struggles and fair shares. Well, the Texas defense on the opposing end gave up too many big passes, and we already saw that unfold in the first quarter. So I want to see how this Texas defense responds on the white and the orange team as big plays have been given up on both sides of the ball.
Sark told us Arch getting more comfortable settling in the pocket this spring. He fires a dart over the middle, and that one hauled in by Ryan Niblett.
And by a dart, that is the absolute truth. How much spin he was able to put on that, finds him running wide open in the middle. Shout out to Ryan Niblett getting his first catch of the day.
Trey Wisner in the backfield behind Manning. He gets the carry. Wisner with some room. Heading to the edge. Look at Trey Wisner showing off the speed before he's finally run out of bounds. However, we may have holding.
A lot of times, if a back is able to find the edge unopposed, it's usually because of a hold that takes place on the outside of the ball.
We mentioned Sark said that Arch getting more comfortable in the pocket. You know, he has such great athleticism, especially for his size, as we get another look at this one called back. Arch is 6'4", 220, but he may be the fastest Manning since his namesake, his grandfather, Arch Manning, who ran for more than 2,000 yards in the NFL. But Sark told him, don't run unless you have to. Guys who constantly run don't last a full season. They end up getting banged up. Said, you know, third down running, extremely effective, running in the red zone. But otherwise, let's get a little more comfortable in there in the pocket.
Great open field tackle right there.
That one complete to Gunnar Helm. Okay, let's send it back down to Morgan now, who's with a very special guest. Morgan, who you got?
Well, Alex, I heard you toss to me earlier, but I was trying to track down the most popular guy on the sideline today, Bijan Robinson, getting high fives from everybody, from people on the sidelines to people in the stands. How much are you enjoying this today?
Yeah, I mean, I love it. You know, I love coming back here. Love just being, you know, with all the fans, with everybody here that supported me throughout my time. But just me being back, I feel like it means something, just not to my family, but to everybody. All the fans, all the teammates, all the coaches, like, because we all been through it together. We all celebrated together, and just seeing like what we're doing now, what they're doing now as a team, like, it's been a blessing, and I'm just happy to be back.
How did the University of Texas and this place, these people, prepare you for what you're experiencing now in the NFL?
Yeah, I mean, what I didn't realize is like there's so many alumni all over the country, and you know, even in Atlanta, like, it's so big, and just I went to something like last month, this Texas, you know, one fun thing, and you know, there were so many people there that went to Texas, and it was just a good feeling, just knowing that just so many people support me and how much I, you know, try to support this university with everything I do. You know, it's definitely been something that I cherish and that I will never take for granted.
New head coach and new quarterback in Atlanta. How are the Falcons looking?
Oh man, we're excited. We're ready to go. Obviously, yeah, it looks good on paper, but we have so much work to do. And, you know, with Raheem, like, it's been super fun, super awesome. Like, we just, you know, we love playing football. But it's definitely something that we love and cherish, and we're just trying to, you know, work hard so we can be the best that we can in the season.
As far as what you've seen from these backs here with Jaden Blue and C.J. Baxter, what stood out? What's impressing you about those two?
Yeah, I mean, they're two different backs. You know, with Jaden, you know, he has the speed, he has the explosion, you know, the quicks, make people miss. And then, you know, with C.J., you know, he's more, you know, power, but with speed, with wiggle. But they complement each other, you know, really well. You know, just like me and Roshan did, you know, when we were here. So I'm excited to see what they do. You know, I can't wait to, you know, really get to talk to them and sit down with them and just talk ball and film. So I can try to make them the best players that they can be with the God-given talents that they already have. So I'm excited for them.
A new conference, a new era for Texas this season. Which game do you have circled on your calendar?
Yeah, I mean, probably Georgia, just because I'm in Atlanta, so it's two, you know, areas that I'm in, and, you know, I can't wait to see that game. And I guess I feel like whoever wins that game is going to be the best team in college football. So, you know, it's going to be a fun one to watch, and I'm excited.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Bijan. Yeah, I appreciate the time.
Thank you.
Alex?
Thanks, Morgan. Great seeing Bijan here. And you may have seen on your split screen, C.J. Baxter just truck a defender there. Nobody told him it's a spring game. He ran over, I believe it was Michael Taff. Oh, boy.
That was before he ran through three tackles prior to that.
Right. Giving him a rest after that, replaced by Jaden Blue. Arch decides to step up and run on third down. And again, he can move. Surprising athleticism for a guy his size. He's a big dude. When you stand next to him, you realize how big he is.
Yeah, here's what's critical about this play, though. It's third and three, right? Texas needs to find a way to get a first down. His options are not there. Instead of taking a sack or throwing the ball away, he tucks it and is able to pick up a first down. That moves them right inside the 30-yard line.
Sark said the most effective running you can do as a quarterback, third downs like we saw there, and in the red zone. Texas with a handoff now to Trey Wisner, who's coming off an excellent spring. The coaches love how he looked. Remember, had the nice game against Texas Tech last year, 7 carries, 60 yards. The sophomore getting a few carries here in quarter number two for Sark.
Yeah, I really love the way Trey Wisner approaches practice every single day. That's a guy that's hungry. Coach Choice has talked about him every single time I've had an opportunity to mention him. You heard Coach Sark talk about him as well. He has big upside this upcoming season.
Second and 10 for Manning. Fires it over the middle. That one hauled in, and a touchdown by Jaden Blue. Arch with two touchdowns on the day.
Again, what a perfect opportunity to showcase his poise in the pocket. You see him steadily going through his reads and his progression. He finds the guy that he's looking for, puts the ball right on him in a bullet format, and Jaden Blue is able to do the rest. That's what you want to see from a young freshman quarterback, be able to make plays like that. Remember, it's a third and three prior to this drive. He was able to keep the drive alive by picking up the first down with his legs. Now he uses his arm.
All right, Fozzie, not a bad performance from Arch so far. 5 for 5, 2 touchdown passes. Central in Ann Arbor on September 7th. So here we go, less than 7 to play in the first half. Oh, got a little trickery here. That one overthrown by Ryan Wingo.
We've seen this in the past. Xavier Worthy typically was the guy that was the double pass guy. Well, it seems as though Sark has found his new player to throw the ball, and Ryan Wingo absolutely let that ball fly. It was a little too far for fellow freshman receiver Parking Livingstone, but it was good form. And it got where it needed to go, just a little too far.
Just a yard or two in front. The adrenaline was flowing. Second and 10 for Trey Owens. Blitz is coming, and that one blown dead. Send it back down to the field with Morgan Uber. Morgan.
Here with Quinn Ewers. Quinn, third year in this offense under Sark. What is it that you really focused on here this spring?
You know, I think just honestly getting back to the basics. Because like I've always said, how you do small things is really how you do all things. And just focusing on, you know, minor details, because that just, when you focus on the minor details, everything else kind of works out.
For Arch Arch Manning today, taking the majority of the snaps. What development did you see in him this spring that's really translating so far here early in this game for Arch?
Okay. Yeah, you know, I think that just goes to show how hard he's worked this spring and this entire offseason to get to the position where he's at right now.
How is the rapport and chemistry coming along with the receivers?
It's coming along for sure. We got a lot of new guys in that room, and I couldn't be more excited for all those guys.
With the big outside external expectations for Texas here in 2024, how do you handle that pressure?
I think we all handle it the same, and it's just focusing on the opinions inside of our four walls and not worrying about what all the media is saying and what everybody else is saying about us, because ultimately at the end of the day, we all know what's true about us, and we're gonna focus on that and stay focused on what we're good at and what we do.
Quinn, thanks so much for the time. Enjoy it.
Thank you, guys.
Quinn added a little bit of weight this offseason. Well, third down for Trey Owens and drops in a perfect pass to Thatcher Milton on third and 22.
Wow.
Okay.
What an absolute dime right there. Thatcher Milton, first off, is having a spring game of his life. This guy's been on the receiving end of a touchdown, a couple first downs, big play right there. What a shot by Trey Owens.
We heard from Quinn Ewers a moment ago. His deep ball really got going over the second half of last year. Over the last seven games of last season, he nearly doubled his completion percentage on deep passes 20 yards or more compared to the first 15 games of his career. We know Sark loves the deep ball, and he really started connecting there, as we said, the second half of life.
Definitely was the biggest area of improvement for Quinn Ewers over the stretch. The reason why they were put into position to win the Big 12 and play in the college football playoffs was because of that accuracy that he was able to clean up from year one to year two as a starter.
Trey Owens showing some nice accuracy on this drive. Sends it out wide to Jarrett Gibson. He is brought down hard by Colton Vasek. Remember Christian Jones nicknamed Vasek Baby Bosa a year ago in practice to deal with a few injuries with the tackle there. Third and short, one to be exact.
It's an impressive play by Vasek. Also lining up on the left side end, being able to track that ball down by Jared Gibson, who made a great catch and had really good positive yardage on that play.
Freshman Christian Clark in the backfield. And the four-star running back gets the carry and the first down.
Another early enrollee. Something that you want to see from these young running backs is, can they see it and then trust it and set up the blocks while they're doing so? You saw Christian Clark show the patience that he had there and then hit the outside, pick up the first down. Orange gets another set of downs.
Texas with about 18 early enrollees, and that's just the freshmen. We're not even talking about the transfers.
Oh, yes.
Great to see so much participation here in this spring from these new faces.
Timeout.
And time is called. Well, we mentioned at the top of the broadcast, no Vernon Broughton for this one, but we do want to say congratulations to Vernon and his bride-to-be Camille, who are getting married this weekend. The coaching staff originally said, yeah, he's off in Paris. And we all looked at each other like, what? Paris, Texas, that is, to get married. Again, congratulations to Vernon Broughton.
Congratulations, brother. Coach said Paris, and I said, man, NIL deals must be phenomenal in today's time frame. But that's huge for this team. In general, you want to talk about leadership stepping up, especially in that room where we talked about earlier, replacing Byron Murphy and Tavondre Sweat, a guy that's getting married, showing that leadership, showing what he has to do. That's what you want to see step up and make big plays.
Broughton and Collins taking over, notably in the middle for the likes of Sweat and Murphy. By the way, speaking of that duo, the NFL draft coming up on Thursday. First and 10, that one batted in the air. Jumping in front of it was Austin Jordan, the junior out of Denton.
This is a perfect opportunity to see how the offense and the defense responds, right? Little over 2 minutes. This is a two-minute drill situation. Situational football is what wins and loses games. Austin Jordan does a great job timing up the throw. Almost ends up with an interception right there.
Trey Owens had to turn into a defensive back and get in the way of Jordan to prevent him from catching that off the deflection. It'll be third and long for the Orange squad. already seen a number of running backs, Baxter, Clark, Red, Blue, Wisner, here in half number one. Another third and long situations for Trey Owens. Remember, earlier in this drive, he converted on third and 22 to Thatcher Milton. So threw a 50-yard touchdown pass to Milton in the opening quarter. Firing it up to his left and drops a dime into the hands of Ryan Wingo. Touchdown, Orange Squad.
Again, what a beautiful throw by Trey Owens. He has been on the money. 56 yards on that pass to Ryan Wingo. Early enrollee to early enrollee on early enrollee, as Kobe Black was the recipient that was not able to stay with Ryan Wingo. What a beautiful pass. That's what you want to see by this young offense, be able to put up points in an explosive way.
Hit him in stride. Trey Owens, Sark called him a natural passer, said he can make all the throws, put up unreal high school numbers, more than 6,000 passing yards. Owens and Manning putting on a show here in half number one. Arch just with a bullet in there, finding DeAndre Moore.
Again, the zip that Arch is showing on his passes is visible from up here. It's getting there with a lot of power. Showed you what he can do whenever he has the ball in his hands.
He's 6 for 6, 7 for 7. Jaden Blue with the catch.
Again, another opportunity for Sark to see what the white team can do in a 2-minute situation. Orange defense out there, they got to keep the ball inbounds, find ways to get the offense to stall out.
Eight for eight, Arch Manning. This time hooking up with Matthew Golden, the junior transfer out of Houston.
These are beautiful throws. That's a cross field throw right there from Arch Manning. Be able to showcase the arm talent once again, finding one of his receivers, Matthew Golden, who will probably have a positive impact on this Texas offense.
Less than a minute to go in the half. Another completion for Manning, this time to Gunnar Helm. Helm had 14 catches a season ago.
This is a perfect 2-minute drill for Arch Manning, leading it flawlessly at this moment.
Manning 10 for 10, but not much of a game there for DeAndre Moore. Texas over the last 3 years, number one among all Power 5 teams in yards after the catch, obviously a key component of any Sark offense.
Yes, whenever you are able to make big plays, it usually happens because you have really, really good receivers to be able to catch the ball and extend plays after that. Xavier Worthy did a really good job of that a year ago. So did A.D. Mitchell and Jordan Whittington. Future looks bright the way Ryan Wingo was able to catch the ball and go showcase his ability with the 56-yard touchdown reception.
Offense, the name of the game so far in half number one. Owens with a couple touchdowns. Arch answering as well, looking for a third one here on this final drive.
Absolutely. With two more timeouts remaining in the pocket, a little bit under 30 seconds, Arch Manning has all the time that he needs. Don't take a sack. Don't put your offense in a bad position, but continue to reserve the right to kick is what Coach Brown used to tell us. You're already in field goal range. Keep that in your pocket, but be aggressive without turning the ball over.
Third and one, Jaden Blue in the backfield along with Arch. They give it to Blue up the middle, and he has the first down as Texas approaches the red zone. Benda on the stop, 21 seconds to go in the half. Manning, pressure in his face. And that was his first incompletion of the contest.
Usually you see pressure around this area of the field. Defense wants to does not want to give up any yardage. They also want to force Texas offense or the white offense into a field goal that is much harder to manage, and they try to light you up right there. It worked from an incomplete pass perspective. Just got Arch Manning off of rhythm just that bit.
12 to play in the half. In motion is Jonte Cook, then it's Helm the other way. Play clock at 5. Manning over the middle, in and out of the hands of Isaiah Bond.
That's a beautiful pass right there. That's one that you want to be able to see if Bond can come down with that. Arch Manning steps strong in the pocket again. May have been a tad high, but that's something that these, you're on scholarship, that's something that you want to see brought in every single time. We saw drops plague this offense two seasons ago. Not as much last year, but that could have resulted in a big-time touchdown to help tie this game up for the team in white.
Through the hands, third and 10.
There you go, T. Get your hands up.
Manning out in the flat to Baxter. And steps out of bounds with 1 second on the clock. What do you draw up here, Fuzzy?
I would probably say field goal, but this is a spring game. Maybe you can be a little bit more aggressive, right? Sark can overrule anything, but probably a great look to see what Bert Auburn does in this situation.
He's been busy with the extra points in this half. 82% career field goal percentage. This will be from 32 yards out. And it is good. So there you go. We've hit zeros on the clock. Half number one of the 2024 spring game in the books. What a half it was for the quarterbacks, Arch Manning and Trey Owens.
They have been absolutely amazing. Exactly what you want to see from young quarterbacks. Trey Owens doesn't even look as though it's his first semester on campus. This guy has been absolutely amazing. And then Arch Manning coming into year number two underneath Steve Sarkisian's season, taking full advantage of it. Only two
in Uber down on field levels. We get ready to start half number two. Morgan.
Coach, an exciting first half. What do you like first off from Trey Owens?
Well, I thought Trey, you know, as a young player, when he's got time and he knows where he's going, he's making really good throws. He's been doing that all spring.
Yesterday, it was officially approved by the NCAA with the coach to player comms. How has that been working out for you guys? How have you been utilizing it today?
Well, it's been really good. Our quarterbacks are on it right now. We only have three devices, so all three quarterbacks have been on it. When we come back in fall camp, the defenders will get involved with it as well.
Speaking of defense, what adjustments maybe do you want to see them make a little bit here in the second half?
Well, they're playing really good against the run. We got to try to minimize some of these explosive pass plays.
Thank you, Coach. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, Sark brings up a very good point. You can use the helmet-to-helmet communications now. The way it works is, on offense, the play caller will get in the helmet through the headset of Quinn Ewers, whoever's in at quarterback. Now, that communication shuts off, Fozzie, at the 15-second mark on the play clock, but up until then makes things so much easier. However, as the head coach pointed out, the defensive coaches were not too happy that that system was not available to them. PK just shook his head. Pete Kwiatkowski, the defensive coordinator, telling us, yeah, we're going to have to wait till the fall to work that out. But obviously for the offense, it's going to be a big help.
I think so. Obviously, whenever you're in football, crowd noise is still a factor. Signals will still be implemented in your normal routine day to day. But ultimately, it gives an opportunity to not have to signal and keep the offense running at an even faster pace.
And the player with the headset on offense and defense will have a green dot on their helmet, signifying they're the recipient of that communication. And Colton Vosick was there in the backfield right about when Jarrett Gibson got the handoff.
That's what you want to see from Colton Vosick, the Westlake product, being able to beat that tackle on the inside move and then force a TFL, something that this Texas defense was able to do at an alarming clip last year in a positive way.
Loss of four on the opening play from scrimmage of half number two. Owens with the fake under pressure, and they blow the play dead.
Again,
there you go.
Colton Vosick.
Yes, he is.
He's
everywhere.
Making his living in the backfield right now, flying across high effort plays, high energy, has really good elusive hips right there. He reads the block on the boot, finds a way to get around it, and then in real play, that would have been a sack.
I think in a game like this, fans don't care about the play blown dead. They want to see that completed for the touchdown, see the end result of that play. It's officially third and 19. Vosick busy in the backfield here in the third quarter. Christian Clark beside Owens. He's already converted on a couple of third and longs, has Trey Owens. one third and 19. And that one well out of bounds and over the head of Ryan Wingo. The coaches told us, listen, with the new college football playoff format, we are going to have longer seasons than ever. If you want to win it all, you're going to potentially have to play 15 or 16 games in a year. This depth is so crucial for this squad. They plan on rotating a ton of players at a number of positions early on in the year, Fozzie, so that they are well rested for the second part of the season.
Yeah, whenever we talk to Coach Sark and Coach Kwiatkowski.
Here's Manning. Another completion. This time it's Isaiah Bond hanging on to that one. Arch Manning now 12 of 14 on the day.
You can really see the explosiveness by Isaiah Bond. That's just a small, quick screen. Get the quarterbacks in rhythm. Isaiah Bond turns that into a nice 5-6 yard gain for this Texas White offense to stay on schedule.
Bond, of course, had that huge 4th and 31 grab in the Iron Bowl. Is that one hauled in by Isaiah Bond? When he was with the Tide again, had that clutch grab. Coming up with a few nice catches here.
Yeah, this is a clutch grab right there. 2nd and 4. Find a RPO opportunity. Gavin Holmes, defense draped all over his back. He finds a way to come down with the contested catches, and that is what you want to see from a guy that's transferred in with high expectations in his offense.
Yeah, hanging on to that ball here in the third quarter. Fake to Baxter. Manning has all day and finds a wide open Jonte Cook. Taken out of bounds inside the 5.
This is why Coach Sark, and I know he's not calling the plays right now. This is A.J. Milwee calling the plays, but they have similar tendencies. Get started on a small rhythm pass. That puts Arch in rhythm. Now 3 straight completions in the red zone right inside the 5-yard line.
Here we go. We want to see how the Texas red zone did offensively. Baxter staying on his feet, sticking with it, and brought down at the 1. Andrew Makuba, the transfer from Clemson, was in on the tackle.
That was a strong run there by C.J. Baxter. What you would love to see from the defense is them finding a way to add some more help rather than allowing Andrew Makuba to make that one-on-one tackle right at the goal line.
2nd and goal from the 1. Again, it's Baxter up the middle, pushing the pile, and he is in for the touchdown.
That's what you want to see right there. Big time power back showcasing his power. The offensive line, it's a wheel type of attitude whenever you get down there 1-2 yards from the line of scrimmage to be able to go get into the end zone. They put their foot forward, allow C.J. Baxter to get a full head of steam running, and that's what allows them to put up 7 on the board as they take the lead for the first time, 23-21.
First rushing touchdown of the day for either squad. And the extra point up and good. C.J. Baxter punching it in from 1 yard out. One more look at that Baxter score.
Again, you get down here right tight inside the red zone. It's all about attitude. You see the pad level of the offensive line. Whenever they're lower than the defensive line, pad level wins every single time. C.J. Baxter puts his pad lower than the defense. That allows them to go get that 2 yards that they were looking for and put up 7 on the board for the White offense.
C.J. Baxter running tough there, and Sark says that's the motto for this year, tough all day. We said, how did you come up with that? He said, well, my parents grew up in Boston, so naturally I became a huge Red Sox fan. The 2 years ago when Texas was playing Alabama, Roger Clemens showed up on the sidelines, and Sark said, listen, I've always been a huge fan, really admired how intimidating Clemens was on the mound. So a few days after.
That's what the defense has been doing so far with stopping the run. They've been tough all day. Besides the run that C.J. Baxter was able to get into the end zone, they've been very stingy, and that's been Alex January early and Roe Lee being able to make a good move on that offensive lineman inside swim and then find a way to penetrate another young guy that could possibly fill the role of what Sweat and Murphy are leaving behind.
A freshman out of Duncanville. 3rd and long. So Owen's got a first down on a 3rd and 22 and a 3rd and 19. Has to hurry that one out. And was under heavy pressure. Colin Page couldn't hang on.
That would have been the perfect play call in that situation if they could have executed. A little bit hot on Colin Page's hands. They call a screen play, dial it up. Wow, that they had a blitz in line. That's the exact call that you want against that situation. Just couldn't execute properly.
Well, Texas is going to have one of the toughest schedules in the nation coming up when they enter the SEC again, the season opener, 133 days away when they play Colorado State. But after that, the schedule difficulty increases tenfold. Now, heading into the season, according to ESPN Bet, Texas with the second best odds to win the SEC behind Georgia. A line for that Michigan game has already come out in Ann Arbor, Texas. Favored by 3.5 on the road there. That should be interesting. Michigan lost everybody from that team.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
New quarterback in the game, Joe Tatum, a junior out of Los Angeles. Incomplete. Third and five. So we saw Quinn Ewers for about two series, two and a half. And after that, it was the Arch and Trey show, Manning and Owens with an aerial assault. Third and five for Tatum. Out to his right. Won't be enough for a first down. But it is complete to Amari Nyblack. And again, who's going to replace Jatavion Sanders as far as the tight ends are concerned? We heard the coaches gushing about Juan Davis, saying he had a great spring. Haven't called his name here so far today.
First and one. Down.
Nope. They're trying to call the offsides. I think Joe Tatum got him.
We'll see what the referees say here. But fourth and one in this type of situation, the defenders must know the offense is going to try to get you on a double count because it doesn't hurt them.
Offside on the defense, number 84. 5-yard penalty results in a first down.
From the head coach perspective, though, that's not what you want to see. You want to see discipline on the defensive side of the ball. They call it earmuffs is what coach yells out on the defensive side. Earmuffs, earmuffs. Don't worry about the hard count, right? Block it out. Find a way to stay disciplined. Don't allow them to get a first down the cheap way.
Here is Kai Woods with the carry. You could see the defenders all pointing in the backfield saying they were drawn offsides. Texas player moved regardless. The penalty stood. Kwiatkowski looks on again without a number of players in this one. Vernon Broughton not playing, Baron Sorrell not playing, and Jahdae Barron not suiting up in this one.
Coach Kwiatkowski on the sideline looks like he is not a happy camper. If you're talking about giving up a free first down and you work so hard to get into a fourth down situation and you allow the offense to be able to pick it up by just using a hard count snap, that's not something that you want to see, and I'm sure they'll be going over that and discussing that whenever this game is finished.
We talked about the defensive line changes for his squad with Sweat Murphy moving on. How about the linebacking core? Anthony Hill moving to the middle.
Woo!
Moves up the middle by Kai Woods, the junior, before he's finally dragged down by Terrence Brooks. But, Fozzie, let's talk about those linebackers. Hill moving to the middle, what do you make of that situation?
Yeah, it's big shoes to fill. Obviously, Jalen Ford has been holding down that move. What a move right there by Kai Woods. I can't bypass that. Jelani McDonald, one-on-one in the hole. Kai Woods makes a miss. What an awesome play. But Anthony Hill has an opportunity to be the hammer for that defense and really take over in the same way that Jalen Ford was able to solidify himself as a great Texas linebacker.
Kai Woods bottled up. The coaches also said Leon Villafau had a great spring. Love the effort, rave reviews. Of course, you bring over the transfer Kendrick Blackshire as well, a few guys to keep an eye on. In the secondary, Andrew Makubo, one of the new faces. And when we talked to David Benda yesterday, as Tatum out to his left of that one, off the fingertips of Juan Davis, talked to David Benda, and when we mentioned Andrew Mukuba's name, mm-hmm. Benda's eyes lit up. He said he had an unbelievable spring. I mean, Makuba's a player who's a former freshman All-American. He was the first true freshman defensive back in Clemson history to start a season opener. It's been good things from him this year in the secondary.
Absolutely, especially whenever Texas had secondary depth a season ago. He's a guy that helped shore up that depth immediately and provide some big-time opportunity with big-time playmaking ability, which he showcased in his previous seasons at Clemson.
How much do you take out of the offense's performance in a game like this, a spring game, compared to what you see out of the defense?
I think there are positives and negatives on both sides of the ball as we line up here, fourth down, getting ready to see Bert Auburn have an opportunity here. But the defense really has to find a way to be more of a factor, right? It started off with the defensive play, Alfred Collins, Ethan Burke on the tip, being able to return it, and then we haven't really seen much defensive success moving forward, and the offense has had their hands full, as Savea almost had an opportunity to block that extra point, right, or that field goal attempt there. But defense has to find a way to shore it up.
It was good from 33 yards out. Burt Auburn, 27-21, white squad in the final minutes of the third.
Jatavion Sanders just wanted to jump right in. Nice enough to pick up my notepad here. But Jonathan, for you, how are you progressing? How are you doing with your rehab right now?
I'm doing good. Everything's kind of going as planned. You know, just getting in my rehab process where I start running, cutting, and just, you know, still keeping my faith in God and trusting my knee.
What are your plans for the NFL draft? Where are you watching? Who will you be watching with?
I'm going to be doing it back at home in Hallettsville. I'm doing it with my family back home, my immediate family back home.
You played in so many of these spring games. To look around and see this type of crowd and knowing the mindset that it takes from these guys, what are they thinking? How are they preparing coming into something like this?
For them, I mean, transitioning into the SEC, obviously there's a lot more little pressure, as people would say. But, you know, playing football, I mean, it's what everyone's done their whole life. So it's kind of just, it kind of comes natural. Just, you know, they're probably out there, just nerves are working. But, you know, it's what we do all throughout the year, all of our lives. So it kind of just comes natural, and they're just doing their thing.
Thank you. Jatavion, for you, NFL draft week, what are your plans? Where will you be watching and who with?
Yes, ma'am. I'll be back home, my family, you know what I'm saying, back in Denton, Texas. Like JB said, my immediate family, couple coaches who's helped me in my lifetime and my day one friends.
What was that experience like for you going through the combine, and how did Texas prepare you for that opportunity?
It's all a dream come true, you know what I'm saying? Ever since I started playing football, I wanted to go to the NFL. And then having the opportunity this year as my junior year, coming out early, and then be able to compete at the combine with some of the greatest talents in the nation. It's all a great feeling. I'm blessed to be here. Texas has helped me tremendously get to where I'm at. I'm so thankful for this university and for the teammates I've had, coaches I've had the past 3 years. I'm just so thankful for everybody.
There's a lot of external questions of who's going to replace you. Why do you have faith in Gunnar Helm and guys like Juan Davis as well?
No doubt. We came in together, you know what I'm saying, the 21 class, and I've seen them grow as men and as players, just like they seen me grow. And I'm excited. Gunnar and Juan, this is going out there and dominant like they've been doing. I can't wait to come back and watch a game this season.
Thank you so much. Appreciate the time. Best of luck to you. Thanks.
All right, great to see those guys get ready for the draft. Meanwhile, while the interview was taking place, you probably saw there on the side of your screen our first interception of the contest, courtesy of the five-star recruit out of Waco, Kobe Black. He picked off Cole Lord. So that leads to this possession. Arch Manning back in the gun. Amari Nyblack with the grab, but let's go back to that interception by Kobe Black moments ago, Fozzie.
Yeah, this is what we talked about right before break, was seeing the defense make a play. And there you have it right there, big-time recruit Kobe Black now being able to showcase his talents. Got beat by Ryan Wingo in the first half for a big-time touchdown. How does he respond? He just shows up in a big way, forces a turnover, gets the ball back to the white team in scoring position.
You talk about a kid who can do everything in high school at Connolly and Waco. As that one dumped off in the flat to Nyblack by Arch and then hammered out of bounds. The strong hit was Jelani McDonald. You talk about Kobe Black, as we'll get another look at this one. Kobe Black played wide receiver, running back, safety, cornerback. And the wrap up by McDonald. How many positions you play in high school, Fozzie?
I only played one.
Really?
Only played one, running back. That was it.
You can do it all.
Kobe Black can do it all.
You back on returns, special teams?
Only whenever necessary.
Another flag here.
Illegal snap on the offense, number 76, 5-yard penalty. It is first down.
The officials want to get a little air time. We hadn't called on them too much in the first half.
Yeah, this drive is not what you want to see from the offensive perspective. You start off the drive with a holding, so you end up first and 25. You're able to overcome that. Now you go into a situation that puts you in first and 15.
And they will take it to the end of the third quarter with the white squad up by six.
Get in there on the 2-yard run. I think overall the running backs have done a great job.
Arch is back out here for quarter number four. To his left, and a wide open receiver led Matthew Golden a little bit too far.
That was really close. That's also where you want to see the defense be able to take care of each other. I thought Terrence Brooks could have actually put a shot on Matthew Golden there, understanding it's the spring game. No need to take that shot. We need you for the season. That's great play by both of those guys.
You saw Golden's head turn in a hurry because he knew Brooks was right there. Arch, by the way, now 16 of 19 on the day. Two touchdowns and over 260 yards. 264 to be exact. Well, Sark told us you wouldn't see much from Quinn Ewers. You would see a lot of Manning, and that is exactly what has been the case. We said early on in the broadcast, so many times in the spring game, you were watching that battle saying who's going to be Texas's starter for the upcoming season. It's been a long time since there wasn't that debate, as the play was blown dead in and out of the hands of Golden.
Yeah, the pressure was forced right there by early enrollee Colin Simmons, and then also by Justice Finkley on the opposite side, number 11 and number 1. Both were able to collapse the pocket, and Coach Sark figured that was good enough for a sack by the Orange defense. That's what you want to see, especially whenever you're looking for somebody to be an edge rusher.
Colin Simmons, big-time recruit. His parents said they put him into football because he was too hyper as a kid. They needed him to calm down and expend some energy. And he admitted he hated football at first. He used to cry going to practices. And now he makes opposing quarterbacks cry as that one doinks off the post. No good off the foot of Bert Auburn.
He's made quite a few quarterbacks cry probably in his lifetime playing at Duncanville. Back-to-back state champion there. Had an unbelievable high school career. I want to say his junior year had 22 and a half sacks.
Yes.
What an unbelievable showcase of ability right there. A guy who Texas prided themselves going after by big time, being able to find a big time recruit like him. And I'll expect him probably to make an immediate impact for this defense.
A 5-star recruit for 12 prospect in the nation, according to ESPN. Here is Cole Lord. Kicked off earlier. And Kobe Black, Jordan Washington with the grab. Freshman out of Houston. Send it back down to Morgan Uber, standing by with David Benda. Morgan.
David, you've told us numerous times, maybe after your football career is done, you might go into sports broadcasting as an analyst. So what is your analysis of what you've seen from your team here so far today?
I've seen a lot of competitive energy. I see that the Orange team we got after in the first half, but we got to pick it up a little bit. But I trust my guys. I know we're capable of doing a lot, but just stay tuned and watch to the very end. That's all I have on that.
You're a natural. This spring, what are some things that you really worked on that you saw translate here in the snaps that you got today?
I would say just being a leader. I really was intentional with just leading the guys and making sure we're in the right spot at the right time and making sure the whole defense was on one accord and one page. That's what I was focusing on.
You had told us yesterday in the meetings Andrew Mukuba was one guy you really were excited to see and had your eye on. How did he impress you here today?
Man, Kuba, like I told him earlier, he had a lot to show, but he said it's just another day in the office. So he's impressed me a lot with how he's handled himself on and off the field and has adjusted to our program. That's my guy, Drew.
As a player, to look around and see this atmosphere, these stands full, how excited are you for the future of Texas football?
It just makes me more excited for the fall because I already know it's going to be a packed out house every weekend. I'm just so excited for it. There's no energy like DKR.
David, thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Like a broadcasting veteran, he looked right into the camera during most of his answers. I mean, he's an impressive guy. We all sat around the table talking to him yesterday, and rather than us asking him questions, he asked each of us who we were looking forward to watching during today's game. One note he told us, and the coaches brought up the same point, when they talked about things he could improve upon, it was being more vocal in a calm way. He felt like he was too frantic at times during pressure situations, not communicating calmly to his teammates. And he said that's something he's really working on. He said, listen, as a broadcaster, too, that's going to help you because he wants to get into sports casting after his playing days are over. But I thought that was a very interesting and astute point he and the coaches brought up about his game.
Absolutely. That's something that you want to see from somebody showing poise, calm, collectedness, especially whenever you start talking about bringing in the defense with the helmet communication system. There are so many things going on. How can you handle that? Be able to put your foot down, assert yourself, communicate to the defense, and make things happen.
Said he stuck around for a sixth season because he wanted to finish the turnaround with his program. Remember, he was a Tom Herman recruit and went through some struggles early on during his career and having that magical last season. And back for one more. Morgan, what you got?
Well, Alex, you were mentioning how David Benda asked us a question. The first time that that's ever happened to us in a meeting like that. And I want to give a shout out to our game producer, Yvan Hickman, who had the best answer. Without hesitation, he said, you, I'm most excited to see you, David Benda. And that was because everyone from Coach Sark to offensive coordinator Kyle Flood to teammates Kelvin Banks in our meetings, they all just talked about his growth, the work he's put in, and the vocal leadership. And you heard that from him today. He knows he has a priority to fill that void of Jalen Ford, who he was majorly impacted by. And he said, really, it was just learning to be even keel in the worst and best of moments. And just be himself was the best advice that Ford gave him.
Thank you, Morgan. Always has a smile on his face. David Benda, great influence on his teammates. Back for year number six. Third and long, meanwhile, with just over 9 minutes to go in the contest.
On the offense, number 51, 5-yard penalty. It is third down.
Penalty on the O-line, an offensive line that, according to Kyle Flood, has seven potential starters on this unit. They said their goal this year is to win the Joe Moore Award for best offensive line in the country.
Yeah, and they got a taste of what it looks like as they played against Washington, who won it last season. And they play against Michigan this upcoming year, who won it back in 2022. So if they want to be the standard, they've already seen what it takes to get there. They're going to have to show that type of consistency, not just in the run game, but in the pass game as well, protecting the quarterback.
Kyle Flood said it sounds simple, but it's all about getting large humans. When an offensive lineman walks into a room, he shouldn't look like anybody else. He should be towering. Texas filled with a number of large humans on the offensive line. Fourth and long for Cole Lord. Over the middle, hauled in and hanging on. Great catch by Jordan Washington.
What an absolutely amazing play. Jordan Washington, enrollee early this spring, coming in from the Houston area. Goes all the way, climbs that ladder, expecting the impact, comes down with the ball. That's what you want to see from the tight end position, especially whenever we're talking about somebody replacing Jatavion Sanders. Make plays like that, and your number will get called.
Absolutely. It was Graham Gillespie with the tackle there, and Washington with some acrobatics for the first down. Savion Red in the backfield gets the handoff. Texas now inside the red zone.
Now remember, this is part of the game, right? This is the orange team with the ball. They're down by six, 7 minutes left on the clock. Just converted a 4th-and-13 opportunity right there. This is where clutch time moments need to have happen. Jordan Washington making a big play like that, showing up in a clutch time situation.
Second and eight for the Orange squad. Colin Page replacing Savion Red. It may have been deflected. You can see a little bit banged up on the play as Hamilton McMartin, the junior out of Katy. And we'll check on him.
Kobe Black right here in on the coverage. Finds a way to be able to. It looked like it did get tipped by Jordan Rubel Johnson, another early enrollee. But Kobe Black had sweltering coverage on McMartin there.
Third and eight for Lord. Somehow through traffic, threads the needle. Nice accuracy by Cole Lord to Remy Patson, the Austin native. Westlake product.
Absolute dime right there by Cole Lord. Defense draped all on him again. Jordan Johnson Rubel is right there. Xavier Filsimi, another early enrollee in on the tackle, but not before that first down throw gets there. This Texas Orange offense is finding a way to create some momentum to try to take the lead late in the fourth quarter.
First and goal. The senior Lord with a nice drive. See how it ends. And once again in the backfield, Colton Vosick. Fozzie, we've been calling his name the entire second half.
Yeah, he might as well line up on the offensive line the way that he's lived in the backfield today. Colton Vosick, this is a guy that's been injured in the past, like you mentioned. It helps if you block him. If nobody blocks you, you better make the play, and that's what Colton Vosick did, as he's done that on multiple occasions, whether the offensive guy was there or not.
So it's second and goal from about the 13-yard line. Hand off up the middle, Jarrett Gibson. Back down close to the original line of scrimmage. Darion Gillette with the tackle. This is a guy who was highly recruited, highly ranked, coming out of Marlin, Texas. But he hasn't played a regular season game in 2 years, had the injury his senior year of high school. And recuperating, when healthy, he could be a force.
Talked to Coach Torrey Becton, the strength coach. He mentioned he is one of the most athletic specimen that they have on this team, especially within the linebacker room. So expecting big things from him now that he's healthy.
Third and goal. Lord, and tackled immediately after making the grab is Reese Beauchamp.
Here we are, down 4 minutes and some change. Fourth quarter.
What's the call?
You got to go for it. You already went for it. Fourth and 13 early on this drive with 7 minutes left in the game. You get a fourth and five opportunity. Cole Lord, the senior, is leading this offense. What play does he dial up? Here's the real question. I wouldn't be surprised to see the back out of the backfield on a free release right now.
Lord fires it into the back of the end zone, and that one is caught by Reese Beauchamp.
What an absolute play. Cole Lord is playing like he's on fire right now. He saw his buddies Arch Manning and Trey Owens getting their shine in. Well, Cole Lord said, it is my turn to do the same. He takes his time to go through the progression, threads the needle through two sets of defenders, find Reese Beauchamp in the back of the end zone. What an astounding play by those two guys hooking up right there at the back of the end zone.
He's had a few throws on this drive with pinpoint accuracy, including that last one as the extra point up and good by Will Stone.
Two fourth down conversions on that drive.
And I know it's an exhibition game, a spring game, but you got a one-point game. These players still want to win it. They're just not out there to totally have fun and entertain the fans.
You got bragging rights on the line in the locker room.
Check out this throw one more time.
And for Beauchamp to be able to hang on to the ball, expecting the contact from the backside safety, knowing he's going to get hit, finds a way to cradle it in, strong hands. That's what big-time players got to do whenever big-time plays need to be made.
That was Graham Gillespie on the hit. He asked me, thinking, what do I have to do to jar the ball loose? He couldn't knock it loose from Jordan Washington and couldn't force the incompletion there moments ago on the touchdown grab by Reese Beauchamp. Okay, here we go. Less than four to play. Plenty of time in the pocket as Arch back out there. Arch playing to the last few minutes of this contest.
Well, Coach Stark said this is going to be his game. Wants to see everything that he has. Another perfect opportunity, two-minute drill. How does Arch handle this situation down by 1 point with timeouts left in the pocket?
Great performance from Manning today. Going deep, has a receiver open. It's Isaiah Bond off to the races. Touchdown, Bond.
Arch Manning is fired up right now. That's the type of performance that you want to see from a guy that's looking to find his way onto the field in some form or fashion. Isaiah Bond showcased the speed, had the early drop, but guess what? He comes back, makes a big play, had the contested catch earlier. Now he burns the defense to put the white team back on top. So much fireworks happening in this Texas spring game.
That is Arch Manning's second 75-yard touchdown pass of the day. Three touchdown passes overall. What more can you want?
Cole Vorge probably asking the same thing that you talked about with Graham Gillespie. I just had to get two fourth down conversions to take the lead, and then the defense surrenders a touchdown in two plays. What more needs to be done? What a beautiful throw right there. Right over the shoulder, Isaiah Bond doesn't even have to break shot. He shows that 10-5 speed that he ran in high school, which made him such a high priority in the transfer portal.
Of this 2024 spring contest. We'll see how the orange squad answers. Oh, in and out of the hands. I mean, that was as wide open of a potential interception as you can get for Zena Amozolo.
Trey Owens back in on offense for the orange team. Trying to make a decision right there. Wasn't the right decision. Zena drops one. Betty wishes he could have that one back.
Another opportunity for Owens. One of his few mistakes on the entire day.
Another reason why Trey Owens is probably back in the game is to see how he handles this type of pressure. Down by 6 points now. 3 minutes and 8 seconds left on the clock. You got three timeouts. What do you do with the ball? What decisions are you going to make in order to help your team get back on top?
Just over three to go. Owens finding Savion Redd, who's still on his feet and finally brought down as he crosses midfield.
Yeah, the Texas running back team has found a way, whether it was on the white team or on the orange team, same exact play. Jaden Blue scored on it earlier. Now you see Savion Redd setting up the outside move, puts Ty'Anthony Smith in a little role of hesitation, and then finds a way to make a big play right there. First down for the orange team.
Maybe a spring game with those competitive juices flowing for Savion Redd and Trey Owens as they try to answer the white score here with 2.5 minutes to go in the contest. Will Randall with the grab. Former teammate of Arch Manning at Isidore Newman in New Orleans.
These guys are playing phenomenal, lights out right now. Both of these quarterbacks, Arch Manning and Trey Owens, have something to showcase and prove, and I think they're doing a phenomenal job of putting their showcase on display. Cole Lord also on that orange team, being able to lead the team to taking the lead this last possession. See what they have in store.
Owens, and in the backfield, nearly picked off. Austin Jordan was right there when the ball arrived, and the white squad nearly came up with a pick again.
That was an awesome job right there by the defense, being able to disrupt that pass. It looks like we have a Longhorn down on the ground as the defender looked to go dive in towards the ball. Might have had his foot stuck in the grass, but that's what you want to see from the defense. You see a short, quick read, and your read tells you to go. That defender did not hesitate, was able to break up the pass, almost resulted in a turnover for the white team to be able to get the ball.
Well, every coach will tell you across the nation their number one goal in the spring game is get out of it without any injuries, unscathed. Jordan Washington here in the waning moments of this one. He had a productive spring game up to this point as Sark looks on. Other than that, we saw a few players limping but recovered fine, and Washington will hop off under his own power with less than two to play.
That's always a good sign to be able to walk off under your own will. Doesn't look like he have a noticeable limp. Probably will be sore tonight, but it's positive from a future standpoint that it doesn't look too detrimental.
When you look at this team as a whole, Sark told us it was the deepest team he's had since he arrived at Texas, and it certainly has looked that way today, not just with the quarterbacks in general. I mean, we've seen half a dozen running backs throughout the contest. Number of receivers as well making big-time plays. Owens to Christian Clark. It appears that Sark is absolutely correct with the depth on this squad.
Yeah, I believe it. It's showcasing right there again. Running back freshman Christian Clark picks up the first down for the Orange team. They're staying on schedule right under the two-minute mark. Still have all the time that they need, down by six. But players have stepped up and made big-time plays all day long, and that's what you want to see, especially from the depth perspective.
The Orange trying for a final score here in the two-minute drill. That one hauled in and brought down. Aaron Butler, the freshman out of California, number four athlete in the nation, with the reception.
Another early enrollee right there. Aaron Butler has big go-time speed as well. So good to see him get his hands on the ball, the opportunity to put his film out there to showcase what he can do as a true freshman. Right under a minute and a half. What's the call here?
We shall find out. Savion Red out of the backfield. Owens finds him, cuts back towards the inside, and finally wrestled down right around the 10-yard line.
Didn't get out of bounds, which actually worked to his advantage in this situation. I wouldn't suggest it. Coach may still have to talk to him. But he was able to gain extra yardage and pick up the first down, which stops the clock once the chains move. And he also probably knows they have three timeouts, so they would have been able to use one if they needed to.
Remember, Red, converted wide receiver, so you know he's got good hands. First and goal. And there is the give to Red. Running hard here in the final moments of this contest. Brought down with forward progress. Probably mark it right around the six. Blackshire with the tackle.
You know what's so important about this part of the game is you see that everybody is playing until the end, and I think that's where the differences between some of the teams in the past and what Steve Sarkisian has implemented since he's come in is building up the depth. But how do you build up depth? Well, you got to have guys competing competitively in practice week in, week out. They're able to have four teams going at the same time during practice. Ones and twos on one end, threes and fours on the other end. Nobody misses a rep. They all get the reps at the same time. And we're seeing that play out in this game as it's literally coming down to the wire in the last 43 seconds.
It's a far cry from when Sark first arrived in 2021 and they didn't even have enough depth to have a proper spring game.
Right.
Had to change the format. I mean, it is just night and day this time around. 24 different players today have caught a pass.
If that doesn't scream depth, I don't know what does.
All right, so here we go. Second and goal for the Orange squad. Down by six. Give to Jarrett Gibson, and the flags fly.
Yeah, there was a face mask by the defender right there. Going to give that offense a free first down and yardage, and the clock stops. So that's a triple negative on the defensive side of the
personal
ball if you're
foul
on the Orange team.
Face mask, defense, number 19, half the distance to the goal. It is first down.
Just grabbing right there. Grabbed a little too much of the face mask. Jarrett Gibson finds a way to create some extra yardage because of the flags that were thrown on the face mask.
Yeah, penalty on Amozlo leads to first and goal. As Pete Kwiatkowski looks on to see how his defense holds up here in the final 36 seconds. Owens, and that one caught for the score by Ryan Wingo and waves to the fans.
What an unbelievable adjustment by Ryan Wingo there, too. Trey Owens just his guy. They get pressure here because obviously the defense wants to force the offense back, put them in a worse position, take a sack, also have to call a timeout. What Trey Owens said, we have the answer to that. Ryan Wingo, where are you at? Let me find you in the back of the end zone. Ryan Wingo makes that adjustment, shows why he was one of the top receivers in the country.
This is one of the most entertaining spring games we have seen around here in a long time. Will Stone. And the Orange Squad answers up by one with 31 seconds to go.
What an unbelievable move right there. Catches the defense on that switch route, not communicating fast enough. Frees him up to be able to adjust to the ball and then locate it in with the concentration. Touchdown, Orange team ties the game, and then Will Stone gives them the one-point lead by kicking the extra point through the uprights.
Owens with his first touchdown of the day for Trey Owens. Three touchdowns, 228 yards, 14 of 21.
Second touchdown for Ryan Wingo. Remember, he had the long one by Trey Owens as well. Unbelievable showcase for the early enrollee, big time true freshman who's looking to get on the field in some way.
Final 31 seconds. Pump fake. Arch fires it out wide. A dangerous pass that was incomplete, intended for Trey Wisner.
I bet Sark is right now just gushing. It's like, I get all of these situational opportunities in a game like atmosphere and see how these guys are able to do. 26 seconds left. What can Arch Manning do, needing just a field goal in order to take the lead?
Manning over the middle with the grab is Jonte Cook. First down, White Squad. That unit trying to hurry up to the line of scrimmage, but time is called.
Again, this goes back to show you the poise that Arch Manning is showcasing. We talked about Quinn Ewers last year during media days, how whenever he first started with Steve Sarkisian, his first year starting, everything seemed like a blur. He didn't even know what calls to make whenever he got into training camp. And then the development that we saw from year one to year two was put on display, right? Almost 3,500 yards passing, 27 total touchdowns, led his team to the CFP. I see that same type of progression happening with Arch Manning from year number one to year number two. The poise he's shown in the pocket, as well as the capabilities to make every single throw today, showcases the development that Steve Sarkisian has put in from year one to year two.
Remember, Arch started off the day going 10 for his first 10. First down from the 39. 15 seconds to go. Manning under pressure. He had to throw it away. Colin Simmons was right in front of him. Simmons helping Duncanville win their first state titles in 24 years. Applying the pressure, and we're down to 13 on the clock.
Yeah, second and 10 right here. Got to find a way to get a chunk play, but also save time. Can't waste too much time.
Nye Black in motion. Manning to his left. Down the sidelines. And too far for Cook. Again, it was Colin Simmons, the freshman out of Dallas, with pressure on Manning.
That's what pressure can do, force you to throw the pass before you're ready to. Jonte Cook got a step behind him, stepped out of bounds, so we would have had to see if he was forced out or touched out. But ultimately, pressure was able to force that errant throw deep past where Jonte Cook was running.
All right, down to 6 seconds. White Squad just inside their own 40, down one. Here's a snap. Manning to his left. Nyblock heads out of bounds right at the 50 with one on the clock. Here we go. We'll see what they draw for this one. 50 yards away.
Got a timeout here, but the guys that were on the field at the time, you had Niblett, you had Isaiah Bond, Nyblack,